Hello and welcome. I am Preeti Prakash. India has been a country with a very rich culture since the time of civilization began. Cut to these times, it is increasingly felt that India's social fabric is in tatters, and people are somehow not very optimistic about the way the Indian society is moving forward, particularly with the younger generation that we have. I have with me today Captain Shalini Singh. Welcome, Captain Shalini, to my show.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thanks a lot.
Captain, if I tell my viewers about Captain Shalini, it's a long, long list. She is presently the member legislative council of Aam Aadmi Party from East Delhi constituency. She's also the general secretary of the women's wing of the party. She is an Indian Army veteran. She's an inspirational speaker. She was Mrs. India 2017. She's a recipient of Veer Nari Samman Puruskar by the President of India. She's a Woman of Courage Award by International Human Rights Council. And she's a proud wife of a martyr who was a Kirti Chakra. Apart from that, she's involved in various social activities regarding slum children, cancer support, animal welfare, and supporting war widows. She's also been the face of the Indian Army campaign of Do You Have It In You, which was put out by the Defense Forces. She's a brand ambassador of many other commercial and philanthropic campaigns. Very, very warm welcome once again to you, Captain Shalini. I would first like to start asking you, what made you join politics after such an illustrious career in the corporate, in almost all spheres of society? What is it that you thought that you should be joining politics?
That's like a very good question, ma'am. Thank you for having me on your show. So generally we have a very common perception that good people from good families, they don't go in politics, and people with ambition, they should not go in politics, and all, but if you are career oriented, you should not go in politics. And for me, it was not like joining politics as in to make some career or do something. It was like I have been associated with so many NGOs and working for the social cause. When I thought of joining politics, it never came to me that I will be joining, like what we say, that I will become a politician or something. I call it a social, we are generally called social activists. Our father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi, he never coined the word politician. It was always social activist, and slowly and steadily it has changed to politics and politicians, and people look at it that if you have nothing to do, you become a politician. But what I feel that the entire country, anything, anywhere on this planet you go, the politicians have a very important role to play in framing our lives, our children's life, present life, future life, whatever, because they make policies, they decide what, how much we earn, how much we pay to them. And I was completely a political person, and this step has actually, lot of my family well-wishers, they're very amazed that Shalini in politics, like two different things. But trust me, it's been 2 years now, I am with the Aam Aadmi Party and with Delhi government, and I have learned so much how this country works, how things move on ground. And for me, I make a very I keep appealing to people that youth of this country should come forward. If you will see, it's very unfortunate that youth is not interested to be part of this nation development. It is only very, very senior citizens. All the politicians I have met, like they are 70, 80, there's no retirement age for them. But now I feel that slowly and steadily I see the change. And for me, it is only that why I'm here is just for the, do my bit in nation building. I have a son, I really want that he should grow in a country which is a developed country, which is economically stable country. We don't have to worry for a lot of things. So that's all I look forward for.
So now you had a good time in public service. You also served in the army, as I just mentioned earlier. Do you think that the respect of defense forces in the society today is plummeting, and they themselves don't really seem to be very happy with the way the country treats them? So they're in a way they're looking for that respect which they do deserve after so much of giving their precious years to the nation.
I will agree to you to some extent on this, not 100% that the defense persons are not respected. We can't make a blanket statement like this, or we can't generalize it. But yeah, definitely, when I got married to a Fauji, it was like in 97, that was the first time I got to know what army is, what defense is. And why, from a completely civilian family, I came into a Fauji family, because my parents felt that defense people have a very different life. They're very respected in all spheres of life. And all. But today, what I feel is, and now in 20 years, I myself see that it has somewhat diminished the respect of people. I will say that social media also has a very important role to play in this, how we are projected. And secondly, a lot of people see, I'm going for war, killing terrorists, bordering our borders, like guarding our borders, and everything is done by defense personnel. None of the politicians have any role to play, right? Even the strategies are also made by topmost leaders of senior officials of army. It is just that the leaders, like the defense minister or whosoever is responsible, give their go ahead. But at the end of the day, anything which is happening, the credit is going to the political leaders. They are trying to show it in a way that everything is being done by them. And I remember there was a time when we used to say that defense people are apolitical and they should stay away from politics. And even when I joined, a lot of people told me that defense people, they don't join politics. But I don't believe in that, that it is not that if I've become a defense person, I can't be further carry on with my national service by getting into politics. But definitely a perception has changed for defense people. That kind of regard which was given to them is not there. And at times I feel it is very much important to keep educating and making people aware what kind of sacrifices, what kind of hard work and struggle they feel. I remember once when I had lost my husband, and few 1 year or so, I had become an officer, but I had gone to some mall. First time I was visiting Delhi and I'd gone to some mall. I did not have that happy self inside me, though visiting Delhi for the first time, I was like, yes, I will go. And everybody was like so chilled, no, or it still sits in my head that the civil population, they are not even bothered. What is happening at the borders? What is happening to the family who are losing their soldiers in war? So more so now, because of social media, that awareness is there. People now are aware. They are now passing on their condolences. But at the same time, it is very short-lived, and a lot of mockery is also being made for many things for the Faujis, which I really. As a Fauji, I feel, first of all, a Fauji shouldn't stand against any Fauji, what may come, right? That is extremely important, because we are one fraternity. And Hamara, we have been like, that is why how defense forces is. Like, we are called brothers in uniform. The families are so united. Even today, my lot of my friends and everybody is from either from my husband's unit or from my own coursemate circle. So, whatever we can have ideological differences, or we can have any kind of differences, but we try and not get it in public. That is the first and foremost rule I think the Fauji should follow. At times I see on social media that Fauji is trying to rip down another Fauji just to prove his or her point. That's not required, I think. not required. If there's a colonel who has put in 20 years of service, and if you're trying to give some wisdom to another colonel who has put in 20 years of service on social media, it is not required. So all these things, we also have to take that effort, and definitely from our part, we have to keep educating, keep making aware the civil population. What are the sacrifices of the family, of the soldiers, the kind of hardships they are enduring. And I think it can be, the damage is not that big. We can definitely undo it by putting the right steps forward.
So as you said, the feeling of one same fraternity, the brother pulling down the other, does that mean that the problem lies within and not actually without? So it's not more of a civil military kind of relationship, it's more the problem has to be addressed within,
right? Yeah, so what I'm saying is, it is not only from one side, it's only the civil population. See, ma'am, if I'm not respecting my own self, I can't expect outside world to respect me. Right? If I am not respecting my colleague who is a Fauji, or if I'm not giving that required respect to my junior co-worker who is a Fauji, then how do we expect outside world to do that, right? And it is vice versa. So it is, I am talking about both things. We have to check, it's like a check and balance. We have to see both things. Where are we wrong and how we have to educate the outside. We can't just put the blame on the outside world and we just can't say, okay, we are right, they are wrong, or they are right, we are wrong. So we have to see what is actually wrong and how we can balance it.
You are a youth leader, Captain Shalini. If I was to ask you, what is the problem that our youth is facing? Our youth does not, can you say that that youth of today is not so much into that feel of nationalism, is not so much into them, the present day youth, as it used to be earlier? They don't relate themselves so much to this feeling of patriotism. It's more of materialism, and their life is more about self-aggrandizement.
I completely agree with you here, ma'am, that what you've said is totally agreeable and I have no doubts about it. I have a son who is 21 years old. He has grown up in a Fauji, not a complete Fauji environment, but yeah, we have always tried to instill that Fauji culture in him. But if you ask me, he doesn't have that dying desire or a passion to be part of the nation or to do something for the service of the nation, right? And I know a lot of children of his age. Because I am a social worker, I keep interacting with a lot of youth in their 20s, in their teens. There are a lot of distractions. First of all, the teens and the children in 20s, the teens and the younger generation, they have come into a comfort zone. Everything is getting to them, they're getting everything very easily. And they are not being taught the history of this nation in the right way. Today, what they see is, in the name of democracy, how things are being manipulated, how the opposition parties, they're trying to tear each other apart just to prove their point right, not thinking and wondering what difference it is going to, what it is going to put in the minds of the younger generation. At times, like the younger generation gets fed up, or they're just not interested because they feel it's just routine to keep ripping apart whosoever is in power and whosoever is not in power. But at the same time, I'll say every political party, every organization, whosoever is in power, are doing their work. They are taking their time. But it's very important for them to keep showing the right things to the younger generation. It is very important to hold that kind of workshops, hold those kind of awareness camps where the youth and membership drives, where the youth can be told that what it means to be part of the nation building. I will give you a very small example of Singhu border. Even my son was not interested to go there, but I told him, come, let's go and see. Once he went there, his perception changed. He understood what this protest is all about. And I never told him that you support the farmers' protest or you don't support. Like, I wanted him to make his own opinion. Why he was not interested? Because he felt that few farmers are protesting, somebody is opposing, somebody is supporting, and it is again some political gimmick. But once he went there, he stayed there for some time, and then his perception changed. And he understood what this it is all about. So as parent, it is, I think, how much we are wanting to be them to contribute is also very important. I have seen a lot of parents saying politics se dur rehna, apna time mat waste karo. College mein, like children, they participate in college election and all. So a lot of parents they say they get involved in things, concentrate on your studies. So I think again, parents have to take responsibility from, it has to start from home, and how much patriotism you want to put in your child. And patriotism shouldn't be that the child is completely finished, he doesn't have any other thought process. Patriotism means that anything you do, like if I'm moving on road and there is some garbage is lying on road, if I put it in trash and put it in the trash can, that is also one step towards nation building. Today's youth, I think they're not even bothered of that. Few are really bothered. They will go all out to do. So again, as I said in my previous answer, it is about check and balance and how much we as parents and we as the elder generation, we want our youth to contribute towards nation building. It's very important for us to take that responsibility and show them the right path.
Now, you have two aspects to your personality. One is presently as a politician, and one is maybe say as an ex-army officer. There are two big, big roles that you have been played in your life. What do you think from, if I ask you from both the perspectives, that the problems that our country is facing?
Okay. So first, I will say as a politician, what our country is. When you say problem, like it's a very generic question, like problem, so there are so many problems. What problem should you want me to talk about? Or you want me to say anything in general?
Any, as you decide.
Okay. So as a politician, I'll say, I will not call myself a politician, as a social activist, I will like to say that, you know, I'm very much concerned about my country. I don't know why, but I was very young when I lost my husband. And when I received this body in a coffin, what first thing I was handed over was our tricolor in which he was wrapped, you know. And I think that was the first time I held the tricolor with some different bottles. And from there, the tricolor has become a very important part of my life. And I have a huge respect for what it symbolizes to me. Symbolizes sacrifice, it symbolizes selflessness. You forget everything and you do your part for the country. I think it is very important, firstly, for us to see how we can contribute for the development of our country. Because if everybody will only bother about themselves, well, it's very easy to say, हमें क्या फर्क पड़ता है, मुझे कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता. It's very, I think, very regularly used words in our country. हमें क्या करना, जिसको फर्क पड़ता है वो करेगा. भले even if 1500 people are getting benefited from one policy, but only one person will be able to take that initiative because he is bothered. The rest of the will see, if he'll do it, he'll get that benefit. I should be. So as a politician, I see that a lot of people, they're embarrassed associating themselves into politics, or they feel, why should we waste our time? Somebody else will do it and we will get benefit out of it. They definitely want the benefit, but they don't want to take that risk, which is not true. I think everybody has, we talk about our fundamental rights, we forget about our fundamental duties. We have few fundamental duties which we are very much responsible. If we say we are paying our taxes and this is my right, so you are getting a lot of privileges being an Indian citizen, so you have few duties also to put in. as a politician, I'll say that we have, this is a problem I see with my, the janta jo hoti hai unke beech mein, when I go and lot of people, I have felt that thing coming out. But slowly and steadily it is changing, though I'm trying to meet a lot of people and it is changing. But second, as an army officer, as an ex-army officer, what problem I see. But for my troops, I feel very strongly because I am a Fauji's wife, I am a martyr's wife, and I have served in the forces myself. Our troops, the defense forces, soldiers, be it the Army, Navy, Air Force, they are putting in real, real hard work to guard us, to keep us safe, so that we stay peaceful. Now, it is our responsibility, it is our duty to take care of them, to think about them, and try and keep this country united. We can't be, they are guarding the borders without thinking of any caste, creed, religion. Our first line of our country is India is a secular country, right? And when they are guarding our borders, they are not bothered whom they are guarding, which caste they are guarding. They are just guarding the Indian citizens and this country, motherland. So as citizens inside, it is our responsibility that we should not have internal conflicts. We should not fight amongst ourselves. We should not be divided with caste, creed, and religion, and whatever we can talk. So I see the problem with our troops that they at times are left clueless. They are being dragged into one side. Some are pulling them onto the other side. This should not happen. Let them
do their job. Sometimes that even the martyrs, you know, are maybe just remembered briefly when they are either awarded or their sometimes anniversary comes. Otherwise, they are generally a forgotten lot.
Yeah. So, like in our country, what is the problem is, ma'am, we associate ourselves with fictional characters like our Bollywood and Hollywood and all those things. But we do talk about our national heroes who sacrifice a lot of things for their motherland, even our heroes who are alive and who are, like, it's not only martyred soldiers, even our living soldiers that have wonderful stories with them and they have been awarded for their gallantry. We should try and put their story in our school syllabus. We should try and talk to children about it. We should try and name things on their name. It is like making a temple in the name of a fictional character, a hero, a guy who has played some fictional character in a movie. He gets a place of God, but a real life hero who has given up his life for guarding your family, he's just remembered on one day, as you said, on his death anniversary or 26 January and 15 August, and it is all done and out. So I think that mindset has to change. We have to start associating ourselves with our real life heroes. We should understand their hard work. We should understand their. It's very important that we should be very conscious of the struggle they are putting each and every day for their survival, so that we survive. So it is very, very important that we constantly keep reminding us.
If I just like to put up a last question to you, that if you were asked in your own bit, how will you want to bring change in the society? What would you suggest? Particularly,
so, ma'am, I think
calling ethics and values in the society.
So, ma'am, it is, you know how very simple line I say, practice before you preach, right? It is, bahar jaake, go and say whatever you want to, very easy, but when you put it in action and then talk about it, it's a little bit not that. I follow, ma'am, what I speak, I follow that in letter and spirit. I don't say only go out and talk about it. I ensure that what I'm talking, I mean. And I think for the nation, it is very important that I alone or you alone can't change the entire country. But we can definitely change what is near us. we can definitely change till where we can extend our arms, right? So it will take little bit of effort to reach out to something where our arm is not going, but if we just push ourselves or pull ourselves a little bit more, we can pick that thing where an arms can reach. So whatever is around us, we know what is right and wrong. We know what is ethical and unethical. Nobody says that I don't know what ethics is and anything. If you are cheating your own self is unethical. If you feel that I'm cheating some other person and he will not come to know, you are cheating your own self also, right? So it has to start from me and from my nearby areas. I do something good, I involve you. You do something good, you involve someone else. And that is how this chain will go ahead. That is how we can make a big karma of that, okay, that everybody is doing. And what is important is that everybody has to understand that. I alone can't change anything. You alone can't change anything. But we all can do our bit. And then we can become one big family, one big team to bring that change. So I think I've been doing that. I will not say that I'm not doing it. It's been many years that I'm onto that path. And I think I am able to, as of till date, I'm able to follow what I preach. And I'm just, I'm hopeful that I will continue doing that.
Tempted to just ask one more question.
Sure, man, sure.
In case you remember some interesting event of your life, you know, which you like to share with us. You had a checkered career of Miss and Mrs. India also, then Army also, then now public life also, then commercial, corporate also. Any interesting event of your life which you like to share with our viewers?
Yeah, what I'll there has been so many stints in my life that there are a lot of interesting things, but I will tell you from the beginning where it started. Like when I lost my husband and I thought of joining the army, it was like within a month of his demise, martyrdom, I thought of joining the army. So a lot of people thought I've gone into mental trauma, and this is maybe because of the tragedy I'm talking nonsense things that I want to join the army. I'm so delicate, and so a lot of my relatives and relatives who were there were saying, yeah, you are so weak, how can you join, sit at home, everybody will take care of you, why don't you want to bother yourself? And so they were like all putting me into a frame of mind that is very weak, only strong people can join, you can't join. And then, but I went ahead with my whatever thought process was, and I became an officer within 1 year of my husband's martyrdom. 20 days short of his first death anniversary, I wore my uniform. And, you know, the same people, they told me, see, I knew you were so strong, you could do it. Only you could have done it, nobody else could have done it. So I laughed so much at that time that they are the same people who felt that I can't do it, I should be sitting, you know, and how the perception changes. So at times we wait for other people's approval to do things. So it is important that if we feel very strongly for something and if we want to go ahead, we should go ahead. See, ma'am, success and failure is not in our hand, but giving it a try and doing something is in our hand. You just sit at home thinking it will not happen, so you will never know whether it can happen or not. So I feel very amazed even today, and those relatives are still very much in touch with me, and now so I am a symbol of strength and an icon for them. So yeah, it is very, I still laugh a lot at how their thought process changed for me.
Thank you so much for talking to us, Captain Shalini, and we look forward to have you more on our show. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It was a pleasure to speak to you.
Thank you so much.